Restaurants and romance, empire and opera, fun surprising experiences at every one of the more than 300 stops on the metro. My name is Lisa. I'm a writer and tour guide. I carry a Canadian passport, but all we'll need is a ticket for the metro system as I show you historic, inspirational, endlessly fabulous Paris. I'd like to share my love for this spectacular city with you, one stop after the next, by way of the exciting Paris metro system. So grab your French phrasebook and put on your walking shoes. We're going to Paris. Next stop, Saint-Paul. We're going to explore the narrow streets and breathtaking old buildings of the area known as Old Paris, Vieux Paris. Some of the oldest buildings in this city survive here, brilliantly restored and occupied by wonderful merchants, scrumptious pâtisseries, and priceless museums. We'll see urban planning, King Henry IV style, marvel at the only Jesuit church in Paris, and the only synagogue designed by Hector Guimard. And we'll taste Italian gelato in the heart of the French capital. Welcome to Metro Saint-Paul, which leads us into the wonderful Marais. Unlike many of the Paris metro stops, the busy area of Saint-Paul and Le Marais are served by a single opening to the platform below. This can lead to a rather busy situation, although it's in keeping with the exciting and vibrant neighborhood that surrounds the metro. To the English ear, Le Marais may sound rather upscale and Parisian, but the name of this area of Paris actually means the swamp. During the 13th century, the Knights Templar drained this swamp for settling. And in the 1600s, this area was known for its humid soil in which locals grew herbs and vegetables. Today, the area is more renowned for its fabulous, rich history and beautiful old buildings. The Marais was especially fashionable in the 1600s when all the aristocrats built their mansions here. Now, though, because of the swampy ground, the buildings are a little crooked. The amazing old private mansions, or hôtels particuliers, are the vestiges of a bygone era of well-heeled aristocrats. The elaborate buildings with private interior courtyards today house great museums and hotels, restaurants and boutiques. But many of these graceful witnesses to the history of Paris came very close to demolition. In the 1950s, a great number of these once magnificent buildings had fallen into dangerously dilapidated condition, with squatters seeking shelter where the aristocrats had once played. In the 1960s, the Minister of Cultural Activities, André Malraux, helped push through a law protecting the Marais neighborhood. The importance of this law is easily understood when one compares the state of the area's gorgeous buildings before the law was passed with the way they look today. Paris continues to protect and cherish its treasured buildings, as is the case with the first place I'd like to show you as we begin our tour. A breathtaking old church with a recently cleaned and brightened exterior, just steps from the metro. You come out of Metro Saint-Paul, and one of the first things you see is this beautiful church, l'Église Saint-Paul Saint-Louis. The first stone of this, the only Jesuit church in Paris, was laid by Louis XIII in 1627, here on Rue Saint-Antoine. The initial construction was designed to impress the faithful, and the additions that have been made to the gorgeous place of worship over the centuries have simply added to the church's glory. The layout is based on the Jesuits' mother church in Rome, the 16th century Jésus. The fabulous interior was designed by Friar Charles Trumel and once held such relics as the hearts of Kings Louis XIII and XIV, although these hearts disappeared during the Revolution. In the 1600s, this church was an incredibly wealthy place filled with art, and it was where the aristocrats went to see and be seen during services. This is a very literary church as well, because Madame de Sévigné, famous letter writer to the court, actually went here as if she were going to theater to look at the richness of everybody dressed up. And later on, Victor Hugo in the 1800s used to come here because he lived around the corner.
The great writer joined many who left their mark here. These giant shells that serve as the church's holy water basins were in fact donated by Hugo in 1838 for the first communion of his sons. The organ was an addition in 1867 and was completely renovated in 1972. Most recently, the Church of St. Louis and St. Paul was beautified through a thorough cleaning and restoration of its exterior. Hundreds of years' worth of grime and pollution were painstakingly removed from the columns, carvings, adornments, and statues that cover this amazing work of religious architecture. This church with two names was originally dedicated only to St. Louis, but when the original Church of St. Paul, located nearby, was demolished in 1797, the two parishes were merged. The clock on the old St. Paul church was saved, and in 1802 it was added to the facade of the remaining church, now known as St. Louis and St. Paul. The Le Marais district of Paris has a little of everything, from the heavenly to the somewhat more down-to-earth. This is the fourth arrondissement of Paris, and as you might expect, there's a gorgeous historical building housing the offices of the mairie, or city hall, in English. But the best reason to visit this particular square is for the open-air market that sets up here Wednesdays from 1 to 8 and Saturdays from 8 in the morning until 2 p.m. Locals picking up a few vegetables for their evening meals call this the Marché Baudoyer. You'll find about two dozen stands in this, the first market in Paris with afternoon hours. Although this is really a small local market when compared to some in the city, there's a nice selection of products and even some freshly cooked treats for you to enjoy as you admire the surrounding architecture. And there is plenty more of the Marais to admire right after this. In beautiful, historical, revolutionary Paris, exploring a wonderful old neighborhood known as Le Marais around the Saint-Paul metro station. Let me lead you a couple of hundred yards the other side of Metro Saint-Paul from the Marché Baudoyer to a place that you would never know was there if you just stuck to the main streets of Paris.
If you're looking to go shopping in the Marais, you should come to the Village Saint-Paul to look at antique shops and specialty shops arranged in a series of historic courtyards.
From the street, the only hint that this place exists is the presence of small, colorful flags at the entryway into the interconnecting courtyards. Here, near the Saint-Paul metro and bordered by Rue Saint-Paul and the Rue des Jardins Saint-Paul, is the perhaps not surprisingly named Village Saint-Paul, where an antiques market is set up in good weather. This lovely old section of Paris alleys and courtyards was spared the sweeping reforms of Baron Haussmann, as was much of the Marais, and this survives to give us an idea of the city's past. The charming old structures went through hard times over the years. Many didn't even have indoor plumbing until the 1970s.
Prior to the 1960s, when this area was in ruins, it was popular as a squat for artists.
The squatters are long gone, but the Village Saint-Paul's boutiques also count a few art galleries among the many curio and antique shops. Serious antique collectors will tell you that this is one of the best places in Paris to hunt for old rarities. And even if you've just come to look and enjoy the surroundings, the Village Saint-Paul is a welcoming delight that keeps itself hidden just out of sight. The interesting shopping isn't limited to the stands on the inside of the courtyard at the Village Saint-Paul either. Just next door to the entry on Rue Saint-Paul is an unassuming little shop you've got to see.
Bonjour.
Bonjour.
Je suis Lisa.
Marc.
Enchantée. C'est tellement petit, la boutique, c'est magnifique.
Some antique shops specialize in furniture, some in artwork, but this tiny little shop focuses on tiny antiques, keys.
So here we are at the shop Au Passepartout, devoted to keys, run by Mr. Mark Feldman, who is one of two or three world collectors of keys. He has keys that date back to 2,000 years, and he has a lot of keys from this neighborhood of Paris. He's a real history buff.
It's hard not to be impressed when you visit Mr. Feldman's boutique of keys. He's a fascinating man and eager to show the objects of his passion to inquisitive visitors. He even let me hold this, a key from the notorious Bastille prison, one of only three known to be in existence today.
The other two keys, one is in a museum, Carnavalet, that we actually visit in the Marais, and the other copy of the key was given by General Lafayette to George Washington, and it exists in a museum in the US.
This key is probably worth thousands and thousands of euros, but there are some much more affordable keys in Mark's shop as well. I was particularly interested to see the bronze Gallo-Roman keys, which survived 2,000 years after they were made, because bronze doesn't rust away in the soil like iron keys do.
The lock looked like this. You insert the key like this, and you slide the lock along. So if you ever need to break into a door from Gallo-Roman times, you're set.
Mark's interest and knowledge extend well beyond his shop also, in the form of his book entitled Des Clés et des Hommes, which means of keys and men. Many of his private collection were photographed for the book, which contains all the information needed for budding collectors to begin identifying old keys.
Bon, merci beaucoup, Marc.
C'était vraiment un plaisir aussi pour moi.
Et super intéressant. Alors, à la prochaine.
Oui.
Holding the old key to the Bastille prison reminded me of another old fortress I'd like to show you, just around the corner from the Village Saint-Paul in the Marais.
One exciting thing about the Marais is that there is the longest section of medieval ramparts remaining in Paris. This wall was built by King Philip Augustus in 1200 before he left for the Crusades with Richard the Lionhearted.
With the dome of the Saint-Louis and Saint-Paul Church at one end of the playground, and this length of restored medieval wall running along the other side, the kids in the Marais certainly have a picturesque setting to boot their football around. Built against the Normans, the wall was originally a height of between 6 and 8 meters, with 77 semicircular towers at 60-meter intervals.
This medieval wall survived because over the centuries, people built their houses around the wall and protected it. It was only in the middle of the 20th century that we actually took away the buildings and realized the wall was here.
Once, this battlement surrounded the entire city. But as the city of Paris grew, many portions of the old wall were demolished and replaced with grand boulevards. Here in the Marais, spared many of Baron Haussmann's reconstructions, the old city fortifications survived, hidden. And today, they're a cherished part of the area's rich history. Over the years, many different cultures have influenced the way Paris has grown and developed. Here in the Marais, a strong Jewish community continues to enrich the City of Light. Let's explore some of this influence right after this. We're in fascinating, enchanting, spectacular Paris. And we've been looking around the neighborhood surrounding the Saint-Paul metro station. This part of the city is a wonderfully eclectic mix of some of the oldest things you can find in Paris and some of the newest. As Paris has evolved through the centuries, so too has French Jewish culture, as is very apparent in this charming little street that goes back centuries.
This is Rue des Rosiers, which was once the center of Jewish life in Paris. It was especially important for the Eastern European Jews arriving in the city. These days, the street has changed a lot. Many of the specialized Jewish shops have been replaced by clothing boutiques. But even today, if you want a wonderful Jewish meal, this is the street to come to.
Many Jewish immigrants came to Paris at the end of the 19th century. They settled and opened businesses in this narrow and animated street. And at one time, as many as 2 out of 3 shops here carried only kosher products. There's more variety here today, of course, but I hope this neighborhood never loses its wonderful, unique flavor. Fans of falafel should definitely visit Rue des Rosiers with their appetites in tow. There's at least a half a dozen stores here serving up generous, fresh, tasty falafel at very reasonable prices. There's no reason to say that it's expensive to eat in Paris once you've discovered a few out-of-the-way hotspots like this one. And if falafel isn't your thing, there's bound to be something to please you in one of the many delis and bakeries that share the street with fashionable new boutiques and historic places of worship. Of course, to speak of the history of Jews in Paris, one also has to speak of the unspeakable. During the Second World War, tens of thousands of human beings were deported to concentration camps from their homes in France. Having fallen to the Nazis early in the war, France left its Jews exposed to the full horrible force of the Holocaust.
These days, there are several memorials to the Holocaust and to Jewish families who disappeared under the occupation. But initially, right after the war, the only memorials were put up by friends and neighbors to families such as the Zasners.
The people of Paris live with grim reminders of the hatred that once burned out of control across Europe. Most schools here bear plaques such as these, reminding passersby that children were taken from their schools, deported to Germany, and exterminated during the war. There are also larger memorials in Paris, like the Shoah Memorial. Shoah is the Hebrew word for catastrophe, and this memorial is dedicated to the memory of European Jews exterminated during the war. The memorial and museum bring together historians, researchers, and educators to be a source of inspiration and memory open to all. The memorial is a resource center with a vast collection of archives on the Holocaust in Europe. A place of quiet contemplation and reflection. But it also stands as a constant reminder of the danger of hatred left unchallenged.
The Shoah Memorial opened to the public in 2005. Behind me, part of the memorial is the Mur des Justes, which commemorates the names of the French who helped save Jews during the occupation.
The Righteous Among the Nations, Les Justes, is the honorific given by the State of Israel to those non-Jews all over the world who risked their lives in helping to save people from the Nazis. France counts some 3,654 names on this list, the third highest of any nation. Another very somber list of names is kept in the Shoah Memorial. The wall of names is made of stones brought from Jerusalem and bears the inscribed names of the 76,000 Jews from France who were murdered by the Nazis. Perhaps the most powerful part of the Shoah Memorial is the crypt. Underground level in a cool, dark room, a black marble Star of David contains the ashes of victims from the death camps. The memorial seeks to give those who remain a place to come and reconnect with stolen families and loved ones. The museum, memorial, and archive at the Shoah all strive towards this common goal that we never, ever forget. Let's take a short walk a little north of the memorial to a place where the Jewish people of Le Marais come to celebrate and worship, a much happier place, the gorgeous and historic Agudas HaKehillos Synagogue, located at number 10 Rue Pavée. This is the only synagogue designed by architect Hector Guimard, who's best known for his wonderful Art Nouveau metro entrances here in Paris. Now, Guimard for this building was inspired by the Torah and the shape of the tablets of the Ten Commandments. Though not Jewish himself, Guimard was married to an American Jew, which is why the last part of his life was spent in New York. With this synagogue, Guimard concentrated on bringing light into the space. The roof has glass panels that let in daylight, and there's a large glass wall at one end. The original design of this wall was far more elaborate, but it was sadly destroyed by a grenade thrown at the synagogue in 1942. Amazingly, however, that was the only damage done to this fine old building during the Second World War. And even during the Nazi occupation, Jews met and prayed here each and every day. Whether designing a synagogue, or a subway entrance, or an apartment building, Guimard always used the same Art Nouveau themes in his buildings. He really believed that a building should be anchored in the ground and grow upwards like a plant. And he used this visual idea in all the details of the synagogue, including this chandelier, which grows upwards very much like a papyrus stalk. Guimard was a near fanatic for detail, and he designed even the smallest components of this synagogue. The benches, the lamps, even the handles on the doors are all the work of this amazing Art Nouveau architect, and they're cherished by the Orthodox Jewish community that continues to worship at this historic Paris site. The area around the Saint-Paul Metro has more than its share of treats for the eyes, but there's also a few for your taste buds, as we'll discover right after this. We're in surprising, historic, enchanting Paris, and we've been looking around the Saint-Paul Metro station through a neighborhood called Le Marais. Many aristocratic Parisians built their mansions here a few hundred years ago. Now the quartier is a mix of all classes, shapes, and sizes. But many of the grand old buildings remain. Let's go have a look at one of my favorites.
If you walk towards the Seine from Metro Saint-Paul, you arrive at this wonderful medieval mansion.
This spectacular old building is known as the Hôtel de Sens. It takes its name from the Archbishop of Sens, Tristan de Salazar, who originally owned the building. This gorgeous palace took 44 years to build and was completed in 1519. In 1605, this became the home of the infamous Reine Margot after her divorce from Henry IV. Margot was said to have carried out many scandalous affairs with younger men here, and it's even rumored that she collected the hair of these lovers with which she made wigs. Over the years, many different owners used the mansion as a home or business. There was a marmalade maker, a glass manufacturer, and even a glove maker who kept rabbits for their fur. As time marched on, the gracious building managed to survive whatever came its way. The Hotel Sens survived revolutions and world wars, even though it partially collapsed due to a poor renovation many, many years ago.
And on the front, there's even a cannonball embedded from a battle in 1830.
One of only two surviving mansions from such an early time. Today, the grand old structure is the property of the city of Paris and houses a beautiful art library. It's a fitting retirement for a grand old house that's known an amazing life. Le Marais is famous for the mansions built here from the 15th to the 18th century. Not all of them are as old or as beautiful as the Hôtel de Sens, but they all have fascinating stories to tell. This is especially true for the Hôtel des Ambassadeurs de Hollande, which was listed as a national landmark in 1924. Looking back into the history of this rather scruffy-looking mansion, one finds names like Charlie Chaplin, President Richard Nixon, Prince Charles, and Sophia Loren among the list of its visitors.
This is the mansion where Beaumarchais was living in 1776 while he was gun-running for American revolutionaries. These days, it's really popular with tourists who come here to take pictures of the fabulous medusas carved into the door.
Paul-Louis Wehler, a French aviation hero of the First World War, bought the mansion in 1951. He and his family worked on restoration for decades. In a rare case of history for sale, this property was on the real estate market again in 2009, when its estimated asking price was said to be over $40 million. The old aristocratic mansions of Le Marais had just about every amenity you can imagine for the day. But one thing they didn't have was electric refrigeration, even though high society has always loved ice cream. Let's take a break from the bustle of the street and head inside to Bozzetto, a little shop in the Marais that serves the best ice cream you've ever tasted.
Here we are in Pozzetto, which is a wonderful Italian gelato shop in the heart of the Marais, on Street Roi de Sicile, so there's even an Italian hint in the name and the address of the shop. And I happen to know what I'm gonna order.
Bonjour.
Bonjour, madame. Bonjour. Je vous écoute.
This cute little shop serves only coffee, sweets, and gelato, but they do everything to perfection, authentic and delicious.
Oui, le chocolat. Merci.
Parfait.
So I've just ordered pistachio, which is my favorite flavor here. It's natural pistachio, really unusual to get. And I ordered black fig, which is this wonderful rich pink color. And I ordered the chocolate hazelnut, which is a specialty originally from the city of Turin in Italy.
Merci beaucoup. Je vous en prie, madame.
Three scoops may seem like I'm overdoing it, but you would do the same if you could just taste this beautiful, fresh ice cream.
Mm. Oh, it's wonderful ice cream.
One of the reasons the gelatos at Pozzetto are so delicious is the complete lack of additives. It's all natural flavor with no preservatives. This means the gelato must be protected from light and air, and it's kept under these insulated metal lids, which in Italian are called posettos. See, in the Marais, you can even get a little language lesson with your afternoon treat. And we have more Parisian treats for you coming up when we continue. We're in the most beautiful city on earth, Paris, and we're exploring the area around the Saint-Paul metro station. This area of the city has a close association with some of the most influential names in French literature. Many interesting writers have made this old Paris of Le Marais their home. Let me bring you to 23 Rue de Sévigny, once the gorgeous home of one of this city's most cherished writers.
This is the wonderful Musée de Carnavalet, the museum of the history of the city of Paris. Anything you want to know about the city is in here. It's also the mansion where Madame de Sévigny, the great letter writer, used to live.
The spectacular mansion that houses the museum dates from 1548. It was home to Madame de Sévigny from 1677 to 1696. The city of Paris purchased the mansion in 1866, and since then it's housed countless artifacts from Parisian history, including 6,000 years of the city. There are countless amazing artifacts in this place, including rare and touching mementos, such as the actual toys and toiletries used by the French royal family while they were imprisoned during the Revolution. And there are more day-to-day artifacts of Parisian life, like this charming 1700s street sign from a wine merchant called the Sleeping Cat. One of the more popular exhibits here is a suite of rooms preserved as they would have been when they were occupied by writer Madame de Sévigny.
This room is interesting because there are portraits of Madame de Sévigny's family, including a portrait of her daughter just behind me. Now, Madame de Sévigny wrote to her daughter almost every single day, and she made sure that her daughter married for love, very rare in the 17th century. Madame de Sévigny also read excerpts of these letters, which were about all the picadillos going on at court, full of gossip and intrigue. And these she read to entertain the queen. Her Highness loved wit and clever entertainments about what was going on at court, so Madame de Sévigny was very popular in the court of Louis XIV.
The exhibit gives a real feel for the aesthetic of her time, and you can read original letters in the hand of Madame Sévigny and pause at the desk from which she wrote so many of her famous letters. But perhaps the most impressive of all is the amazing mansion that houses the museum. In addition to the original mansion, the city of Paris annexed another stately home behind it to enlarge the already generous space. There are three gardens in the joined courtyards, one of which is planted with herbs much as it would have been in the days of the aristocrats. At the Musée Carnavalet, the stunning architecture of the building, the finely manicured gardens, and the beautifully appointed rooms filled with priceless artifacts from an era of opulence all combine into a fascinating lesson in the history of Paris and the Marais. From the place where Madame de Sévigny once lived and wrote, let's head over to Place des Vosges, renowned as the first ever planned square in Paris.
Madame de Sévigny, the famous letter writer, was born in this house behind me in 1626 on the Place Royale, which is the old name for Place des Vosges.
The square was designed as residences for aristocrats, financiers, and the like. It's composed of 36 individual townhouses, 34 of which are identical, with the exceptions being the queen's and the king's houses. These all surround a central grassy park crossed by paths and set with four identical fountains. The central court is one of the best places in Paris to bring a picnic. The perfectly kept grass here is one of the few places in Paris where such an activity is allowed.
My favorite French king is Henry IV, who famously said, "I make love, I make war, and I build." And this is one of the squares that he built.
Although the king didn't live to see his project completed, it remains as an exemplary piece of early urban planning. The lovely brick fronts of the houses are only facades, so as to save on construction costs. The original practical plan included arcaded shops on the ground level. The hope was that this would become the center of France's then new silk-making industry, and the covered arcades would allow for loading and unloading of silk sheltered from the rain. Today, art galleries and eateries occupy the space, sheltering visitors from the rain. Place des Vosges has been the address of more than a few Parisians of renown. Cardinal Richelieu inhabited number 21 for several years, and one of the city's most celebrated writers, Victor Hugo, lived at number 6. Today, the home has been turned into a museum, the Maison Victor Hugo. Inside the 280 square meter apartment on the second floor, you'll find a suite of beautifully preserved rooms, along with many interesting objects from the life of the great writer.
Victor Hugo actually wrote standing up, and he had desks like this specially designed for him. He started writing Les Misérables here in this Place des Vosges house. He actually finished the novel writing it on this very desk.
At the time that Hugo lived here, Place des Vosges had fallen into a period of disrepair. It was far from the fashionable address it had once been and would become again. In fact, Hugo wrote describing this place as a dank, dark prison. The museum is not a perfect copy of the apartment as it was then, but rather a collection of rooms from some of the various residences Hugo occupied during his long life.
The writer also loved to draw and design, often inspired by the Asian art that was starting to come into the capital at the time. He designed this over-the-top salon for his mistress, Juliette Drouet, and he hid initials, his and hers, throughout the room to imply their relationship. In fact, this room was originally in Juliette's house outside of Paris, but it was moved here after the writer's death when this room became part of the museum.
Another of the rooms brought here and reconstructed is the bedroom in which Hugo passed away, brought here from his apartment on the other side of Paris, on a street that's now named Rue Victor Hugo. The Maison Victor Hugo Museum is open every day but Monday, and it's free. If visiting the homes of some of France's most beloved writers has inspired you to pick up a pen, let me show you to a great little shop I know in the Marais, where you can choose from some of the finest writing tools and paper in the world. Just the other side of the Metro Saint-Paul from Place des Vosges is number 10, Rue du Pont Louis-Philippe.
Here we are in Mélodie Graphique, Eric de Tunis' shop dedicated to beautiful papers, notebooks, and calligraphy. He's been here for 26 years.
In a time of texting and limited character counts, it's somehow refreshing to know that there are still people and places where the written word is still written by hand. Admittedly, a feather quill and an envelope sealed with a wax stamp isn't everyone's obvious choice. But Eric assured me that there are still a slew of niche markets for such a skill.
Here you can actually buy sealing wax if you're getting married and you want a really elegant invitation. Eric will actually do calligraphy, and you can get sealing wax to stamp your initials, say, on the invitation.
Eric showed me a little of his gorgeous handwriting. It's amazing to learn that he is completely self-taught. His education, in fact, was in biology, and his first love is drawing insects. He specializes in insects of the Sahara, and you can see cards with his expressive and colorful illustrations on sale at his shop.
I think my favorite bug is this one. I like his legs, he's gorgeous.
You may have noticed how people buying pens like to try them out first. And over the years that he's been in business here, Eric has saved all the notebooks of people's scribblings as they tried the various writing implements he has on sale. Eric now has 53 volumes. I was enchanted to learn that some years ago, Eric noticed that a pair of lovers were leaving each other secret love notes in one of his pen testing notebooks. Their sweet words mixed in among all the test scribbles and signatures. The Melody Graphique pen and stationery shop in Le Marais may have just what you're looking for, especially if you want to send home a really classy letter from your visit to Paris. And there's lots more to visit in Le Marais right after this. In architectural, artistic, astonishing Paris, and we've been discovering the old neighborhood around the Saint-Paul metro station. After a full morning of walking in the narrow streets of this older part of Paris, I've worked up quite an appetite. Let's head back over to the Place des Vosges to a very French, very traditional tea room. The Pâtisserie Carette. I'm going to make the most of this bright Paris day and sit on the terrasse in the Place des Vosges arcades, the better to people watch.
What's great about the terrasse in Paris is that a lot of them have heat lamps, which is good because, you know, this city is not known for its warm weather.
Another nice thing about the terrasse at Carette is its unhurried atmosphere. The tea room has a full menu, but if you choose to just have coffee and a pastry, the formal but attentive staff will allow you to linger and watch the world go by without pressuring you to move on. I'm going to try one of the specialities of the house, and of course, save a little room for dessert as well.
Merci beaucoup. So I just ordered myself a French onion soup.
This busy place isn't the one to choose for a quiet, intimate meal. But if you're in the mood for a classic, buzzing French cafe, some call Carette the best brunch in Paris.
Carette opened in 1927 as a tea room and pastry shop over on Place Trocadéro. This is their newer location on Place des Vosges.
While my French onion soup is bubbling under the broiler, I'm going to have a look at the selection of fine pastries. Carette offers all the Parisian classics, eclairs, pommiers, croissants, but I think I'm going to try something as old-fashioned as Place des Vosges, a nice lemon tart.
Yes. So my French onion soup has arrived, and this is a really traditional meal and used to be the meal of the poor. The bread would insulate it to keep it warm. Let's give it a try. Oh, lovely, lots of cheese, very oniony. And lovely, really a lot of wine in it also, which is nice.
To be honest, everything I've eaten at Carette is nice, from the little bread served with my soup to the gorgeous floral dishes and cups. No detail is forgotten, and each bite is really perfection. You can spend more money on food in Paris, but you won't find much better. I'm going to sit and enjoy my heat lamp, my tea, and my lemon tart as I reflect on the lovely day in Le Marais, this gem of history, literature, and architecture. It's been a pleasure showing you some of the hot spots and lesser-known wonders that abound in this old Paris near Saint-Paul Metro. Let's see what we can get up to next time on Paris, Next Stop.